Chapter 30. We're almost done with the whole book. We got one more chapter left after tonight. And these two are very interesting and different from the rest of what we've been going through. If you notice there in verse number 1, this says, "The words of Agur, the son of Jakeh, even the prophecy the man spake unto Ithiel, even unto Ithiel and Ukel." What we've been reading, for the most part, in the book of Proverbs is the Proverbs of Solomon, right? And that's really what the book is called. The vast majority of these came from Solomon, but Proverbs 30 and Proverbs 31 are not the words of Solomon. It doesn't really matter. They're all the words of God, right? This is all still scripture. So even these wise sayings, God gave Solomon wisdom. God blessed him with that. He gave him understanding. He was used greatly to give us God's word, but ultimately at the end of the day, God is still the author of these words. Now, what I want to point out is something I actually literally just pointed out soul winning today when I was speaking to a man who was going to, his background is in an Assemblies of God church. And there's a lot of things that we were talking about, but one of the things that came up, oddly enough, I was talking about speaking in tongues and speaking with other tongues, show him 1 Corinthians 14. I was kind of explaining a lot of that to him. And we got to the point, oddly enough, where it says, and this wasn't the point of why we went there at all, but in 1 Corinthians 14 it says, you know, let your women keep silence in the church, for it's not permitted for them to speak, but if they'll learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home. And that was a part of the scripture. And he kind of just threw out there that, like, well, I don't think that that's for today. I think we're living in the times of Joel, where it says that your old men shall dream dreams and see visions, and your men and your women shall prophesy. So, which is interesting enough, and I'm not going to get into the whole discussion I had with him, but that word prophesy is what I want to cover right now, and this is what I explained to him, is that, you know, first of all, a lot of people are confused about prophesy and prophecy, and they think that it only has to deal with future events. And that's typically the way the word is used today. When people talk about prophecy, they're talking about an event that hasn't happened yet in the future. Now, I'm not saying that that's not prophecy, right? But the word prophesy or prophecy doesn't always have to refer to something that hasn't yet happened, as in some future event that's going to happen, and, you know, like the Antichrist coming into power, right? That's not the only thing that's a prophecy. What we see here in Proverbs 30 verse 1, it says, "The words of Agur the son of Jakeh, even the prophecy." Now, we read this entire chapter before I started preaching just a few minutes ago. There is nothing in this chapter that's talking about some prophetic future event. And actually, in Proverbs 31, you're going to see the same exact thing. The words of King Lemuel in verse number 1, the prophecy that his mother taught him. And what's Proverbs 31 about? It's about the virtuous woman, by and large. I mean, that's pretty much what the chapter is about. It's known for the virtuous woman. And you know, there's just bits of wisdom and truth is given to him, yet it's called a prophecy. Why? Because it's God's word, because it's the wisdom. It's the preaching of God's word is how that word's used. And you could go all throughout the Bible. I'm not going to prove that just exhaustively tonight. But when you start to read that and you say, you know, when your young men or your men and your women shall prophesy, that's preaching. It doesn't have anything to do necessarily with future events. So, and I explained that to this man too, is that there's no problem with women prophesying. I'm all for it. I think women should be preaching the gospel, getting people converted, leading people to Christ. We saw the woman at the well did that when, after Jesus spoke with her, the first thing she did, she dropped her bucket, she ran into town and said, "Hey, isn't this the Messiah? Isn't this the Christ? Isn't this who we've been waiting for? Come see this man." And she started leading people to Christ. We see example of women doing that, and praise God for it. You know, that great commission was given not just to the disciples, that was given to all believers. To go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, to do this stuff. I mean, these are the things that everybody's job is to do that. When you preach the gospel, you're prophesying. You're prophesying about Jesus Christ. So there's not a problem with that. 1 Corinthians 14, the problem is within the church, within the setting of the place that we all gather together to receive learning and wisdom from God's word. That's when it's not permitted for women to speak. Go ahead, prophesy, go out. You know, go out door to door, go out and reach the lost. Prophesy Jesus Christ. Amen. That's good. And there's no contradiction at all there. It's just a misunderstanding, for one, definitely, of the word prophesy or prophecy. And what we see here, that's why I'm starting off here in verse number 1. Proverbs 30 is a prophecy with no specific future events happening. It's wisdom. We're receiving knowledge. Verse number 2. Surely I am more brutish than any man, and have not the understanding of a man. I neither learned wisdom nor have the knowledge of the holy. Now, this is really interesting, because what we see here, the words of Acher, the son of Jakeh, is humility. This is a very humble man, right? To say, I'm more brutish, right? Basically saying, like, I'm stupid, I'm brutish than any man. He's like, I don't even have the understanding of a man. I don't know, you know, I neither learned wisdom nor have the knowledge of the holy. But let me ask you this. Is what he's saying scripture? Wouldn't you consider that the knowledge of the holy? So, in his humility, he's saying these things. Basically saying, I'm not anything, you know, I'm not some special person, I'm not this scholar, I'm, you know. But he's speaking pure wisdom and scripture and truth from God's word. The reason why I'm making a point out of this right now is because there's an argument that comes out, and I didn't cover this on purpose because there's too many things to cover when I preached on the preservation of God's word. One of the arguments that people will make against people who believe in a, you know, King James only philosophy, King James only church like we are, when we say the King James Bible is preserved word of God, one of the arguments they'll use against that is to say, well, the translators didn't even think, they weren't King James only, so why are you? So they'll point to the foreword, you know, the letter from the translators before the Bible is, you know, in the preface to the Bible, basically, where they wrote this whole long letter and all these things, and how, you know, how humble, first of all, they are when you read that letter. That they are not exalting themselves at all, but they're just doing this work and they're doing this service and trying to glorify God and the things that they're doing, and they're doing their best to put everything together and to basically make a great revision of God's word. Now, they were living at a time where there wasn't one complete source and text of the entire Bible just in its entirety right there to pick up and read. I mean, you had at least not a perfectly preserved one in English. They had these, you know, other versions prior to that, the Tyndale versions, other things, and a lot of those were still incomplete. The works were not just done. They had their bishop's Bible, but they already knew that that was full of errors, which is what prompted this to begin with. They knew it wasn't. I mean, it was known that, yeah, this isn't a great translation. So what they will do is say, well, look at the translators. They don't even say, they don't think that they were being, you know, that they were inspired by God. Now, the word inspired, you know, whatever. I'm not even going to get into all that. Were they inspired? No. But did God use them to preserve his word? Yes. But the argument of saying that, well, since they said what they said, that just means that King James only is wrong, is a false argument. Because they were humble. I mean, look at, because Acher says here, I don't have the knowledge of the holy, does that mean, well, this isn't scripture then? Can we say that? No, it is scripture. Of course it's scripture. He did have the knowledge of the holy, but he was being humble. Think about this. Turn, if you would, to John chapter number 1. Keep your finger here. Turn to John chapter 1. We have a perfect example of this from scripture also. And even a better example than in Proverbs 30. John chapter 1, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John in the New Testament. John chapter number 1, we're going to look at verse number 19. The people were questioning John the Baptist. Verse 19 of John chapter 1. And this is the record of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who art thou? So they're saying, well, who are you? right? The priests, the Levites, they sent people saying, well, who is this guy? Because John the Baptist was out in the wilderness, right? He's just out. He was a voice crying in the wilderness, preparing the way of the Lord. So they asked him, well, who are you? Verse number 20. And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. So right off the bat, he's saying, I'm not Christ, right? Because they want to know who he is, making this big stir and baptizing people and stuff. So verse 21, it says, and they asked him, what then? Okay, you're not the Christ. What then? Art thou Elias? And he saith, I am not. Art thou that prophet? And he answered, no. Why are they asking him if he's Elias? Because the prophecy of Christ says that Elias must come first. Turn, if you would, to Matthew chapter 17. So when they asked him, are you Elijah? Because that's what Elias is in, you know, translated from the Greek. It's Elijah. Are you Elijah? No. Are you that prophet? Nope. John the Baptist himself said no. Let's look and see what Jesus said in Matthew 17. Matthew 17, verse number 10. And his disciples asked him, saying, why then say the scribes that Elias must first come? Talking about before Christ comes, Elijah's going to show up first, and then Christ is going to come. Verse 11, and Jesus answered and said unto them, Elias truly shall first come. He's confirming that that's correct. Yes, Elijah must come first and restore all things. But I say unto you, verse number 12, that Elias is come already, and they knew him not, but have done unto him whatsoever they listed. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them. Verse 13, then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist. Jesus was referring to John the Baptist as being Elijah. Did John the Baptist know that? No. He said, no, I'm not. But was he? Yes. That was the prophecy coming fulfilled of Elijah coming first in John the Baptist. That was the fulfillment of that prophecy that had to happen first. John the Baptist said no. So because John the Baptist said no, then that just means that he wasn't. Because the King James Bible translator said no, we don't, you know, we're not King James only or authorized version only, then that means that's just wrong. You see how the argument just falls flat on his face? It doesn't stand up. See, people being used by God don't even necessarily have to know what their role is or how they're being used by him in order to be used by him. There are people that have been unsaved. Listen to this. There are people that have been used that are unsaved that have been used by God for his purpose and have even spoken God's words. The high priest, when he said that, don't you know that it must needs be that one die for the entire, you know, for the nation? And I'm misquoting that. But when he said that, the Bible says, this spake he not on his own, but because he was the high priest that year, and basically the Holy Ghost, you know, like he said that scripture because God was leading him to say that, and it wasn't of his own. So God is able to use people when he wants to perform his will. And this is what we see, and this is what we believe happened with the scripture. Go back, if you would, to Proverbs chapter 30. So if you hear people saying that, well, the translator said this, don't let that shake you on being, you know, King James only, because they don't have to know how important the role really was in the preservation of God's word and in the translating into our English language. They don't have to have the full understanding of the impact that they actually had in order for it to still be true. Just like John the Baptist didn't have to have the understanding, or Agur didn't have to have the understanding that what he was actually saying was actually scripture. He probably didn't realize it at the time, which is why he says, I don't have the knowledge of the holy, as he's like speaking scripture. Just to go down to verse number 4. Who hath ascended up into heaven or descended? Who hath gathered the wind in his fists? Who hath bound the waters in a garment? Who hath established all the ends of the earth? What is his name? And what is his son's name, if thou canst tell? And I love this. Just in questions, all of the doctrine wrapped up in the Old Testament, in these Proverbs, from the words of Agur here, talking about Jesus Christ coming. You know, what is his name and what is his son's name, if thou canst tell? Turn, if you would, to Ephesians chapter number 4. Because he mentions here in the very first part of that verse, who hath ascended up into heaven or descended? Who is that? Well, in Proverbs, he's asking the question. In the New Testament, we've got the answer. We know exactly who that is. Jesus Christ is the one that ascended into heaven and descended. Because he asked the question, who hath ascended up into heaven or descended? Jesus did both. Look at Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 8. Wherefore, he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And there's a doctrine today that's getting, I don't even know how, just getting left by the wayside, where people are saying that Jesus Christ did not go to hell. And this is kind of mind-boggling to me, because even like the Reformed Protestant churches have believed this for a long time. I mean, this is just something that's so clear in Scripture. Turn, if you would, to Acts chapter 2. This is something that's so clear in Scripture, I don't see how you could miss it. It's so clear that even the false Christian religions are getting it right. Just like the Catholic Church has the Trinity right. It's obvious. I mean, that's clearly taught in the Bible. So it's kind of like, how could you not believe that? This Jesus Christ's soul going to hell is the same exact way. And what we saw in Ephesians 4 is, you know, hey, yeah, he ascended up into heaven. Okay, everybody believes that. Jesus ascended into heaven. He says, but what is it but that he also descended first? And it says here, into the lower parts of the earth. So some people want to say that the death of Jesus is only referring to him being in the grave. Now, first of all, the tomb that he was laid in, there was a rock like rolled over it, and there was somewhere where he could like, you could like walk into. Okay? So maybe he had to walk down a little bit. I don't know exactly how it was set up. But would you consider that just to be, like you said, the lower parts of the earth is this little tomb that's maybe 6 feet under? I don't know. I mean, does that really sound like the lower parts of the earth? Of course not. Because that's not where, when this is referring to, it's not referring to Jesus' body being in that tomb. It's referring to his soul. And we're going to see here in Acts chapter 2 how his soul went to hell and was there for 3 days and three nights. And it's interesting, because we go out soul winning and I try to explain this to people. A lot of people don't even realize this. You just say, well, they've heard about Jesus Christ dying on the cross and they heard about his resurrection. So oftentimes what I like to ask is, well, do you know where his soul was? You know, during those 3 days and three nights, he died on that cross and he rose again from the dead. Do you know where his soul was during that time? Most people say it was in heaven. That's not true. And there's a lot of people that actually say what we teach is blasphemy and all this other stuff, because we teach that Jesus' soul didn't go to hell. And they come up with this weird doctrine of Abraham's bosom, and they turn to Luke 16 and they see the story of Lazarus and the rich man and how Lazarus went to Abraham's bosom. Which, the bosom's a body part, by the way. He went and actually saw Abraham, and Abraham gave him a hug. You know, Abraham was there saying, you know, you can be comforted now. But they want to say that that place is in the center of the earth, and it's just a whole bunch of nonsense, because even science will tell you what the center of the earth consists of. You don't even need science to understand that. You can look at a volcano and understand what is beneath the earth when you see it erupt and you see the fire and brimstone shooting out of that volcano. I mean, it's totally proven. Science will do it for you. Science that's not falsely so-called. Science that just tells you that there, yeah, what's in the core of the earth? Magma. I mean, It's super hot, right? We know that this is a geothermal planet that we live on. There's heat coming from inside of the earth. It's hell. The Bible refers to that place called hell. Hell is never mentioned once in the Bible as a positive place to be, not one time. Yet people want to believe that Jesus Christ's soul went to hell, but he went to the good part of hell, where it's not hot. Well, let's see what the scripture says, okay? Because, I mean, if we're going to believe something, let's believe it because the Bible says so anyways. Not because it even makes sense. But let's just look at here when Peter's preaching. Let's get this in context. Let's start reading here in verse 22. Chapter 2, verse 22 of Acts. "You men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God among you, by miracles and wonders and signs, which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom God hath raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it." So what's he talking about? Jesus Christ's death. He's saying, you guys crucified him, but God raised him up, right? He's talking about his death and his resurrection. That's the context. Look at verse 25. "For David speaketh concerning him." Now he's going to quote the Old Testament. He's going to quote the book of Psalms. "I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover also my flesh shall rest in hope, because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance." And then he stops there. It's a quotation from Psalms. Verse 29, "Men and brethren," now he's speaking to them again after he's quoted the reference, the scripture. "Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his loins, according to the flesh, he would raise up Christ to sit on his throne." So he's starting to explain here that what David was saying in this psalm, it wasn't about himself. But because he knew, and he was a prophet, he knew that God had already sworn him. David had received a promise from God that there was not going to fail man to sit on the throne, and basically that Christ was going to be coming through David's physical line, his descendancy. And that was a great blessing, right? It was a great blessing for you to have that bestowed upon you, that, wow, one day from my son, my children, Jesus Christ is physically going to be born. That's amazing, right? And that's what he's explaining here. So look, he knew this. So he explains it even further. Look at verse 31. "He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption." Completely expounds this psalm. And he says it's not about David. It has nothing to do with David. It's just because he knew that the fruit of his loins, Christ was going to come. He was just speaking about the resurrection of Christ. And he says, this is a prophecy of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that his soul, whose soul? Jesus Christ's soul was not left in hell. Now, in order for Jesus Christ's soul to be left in hell, it has to be in hell first. You can't be left somewhere that you never were to begin with. Now, it doesn't say his soul was not left in Abraham's bosom. It doesn't say his soul was not left in heaven. His soul was not left in hell. Now show me one reference ever in the entire Bible, front to back, where hell is used as a good place to be. Not bad. I'm going to hang out here for a while. I'm going to be in hell. One reference. Just show me one where it uses the word hell. You're not going to find it. Every single mention of the word hell, guess what? It means that fiery, burning, horrible place that even people who've never read the Bible one time understand what you're talking about when you say the word hell. Right. It is a concept that is widely known. in our day and age in a word that is used commonly, and the word means exactly what it says. Hell, the fiery, burning, torturous place that Jesus' soul went to because he was bearing the sins of all the world. Amen. The punishment for our sins, the wages of sin is death. The place, death. Not just your physical death. We get punished without Christ for our sins in hell. The torture and torment is a punishment for our sins. Jesus Christ came to pay for our sins. He paid for our sins in hell. It's a real simple doctrine, but we have the scripture just explicitly stating that his soul was not left in hell. We have Ephesians 4, hey, that he ascended up in heaven, that's great. And he needed to do that too because he had to go before the mercy seat in heaven and sprinkle that blood of the atonement on the mercy seat. Just as they did in the picture or the figure for the time then present when the tabernacle was around on this earth. And the physical tabernacle reflected what's in heaven. The physical mercy seat reflects what's in heaven. That's why God gave them specific instructions on how to design and to build everything, because he wanted it patterned after the way it is in heaven. He said, this is the way it needs to be. And everything that they acted out here was telling you this is what's going to happen with the Lamb of God, the perfect sacrifice that came. And you could go on and read about the Passover sacrifice, how the Bible explicitly says, okay, you need to shed the blood. It needs to be without blemish. It needs to be perfect. Shed the blood. You need to eat of the flesh of the lamb, but you can't leave any of it to morning. He says, you can't cook that flesh with water, not sodden with water, not anything else. It needs to be roast with the fire. And it spells out, it says, roast with fire. And anything that's left over, burn all of it in the fire. Let none of it remain until the morning. Why? It's representation of Jesus Christ. Why does it have to be burned with fire? Because Jesus' soul went to hell for 3 days and three nights. It makes perfect sense. The scripture... I don't get how people can believe anything other than this and how you can try to reconcile all the references. When you just accept it for what it says, there are no problems whatsoever. And it's interesting how we could even see this being darkly prophesied in the book of Proverbs, right? It's like in the Old Testament, a lot of things they were seeing through a glass darkly, just like we do now. But the light of the New Testament really shines a lot on the understanding. I could understand in times past when these Proverbs were given, go back if you would to Proverbs chapter 30, not really being able to understand, what is he talking about? What is his name and his son's name, if thou canst tell, right? What does that mean? What does it mean, who hath ascended up in heaven or descended, right? But now we have these scriptures from the New Testament just completely explaining and expounding and saying, oh, that's exactly what it means. It's exactly what he's talking about here. It's more of a prophecy saying that of Jesus Christ who was to come. Look at verse number 5. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. And again, you know, I don't want to get too far in this because I just preached on the preservation of God's word. Every word of God is pure. What is it? What is purity? There's no corruption. There's no defiling. It is, I mean, definition of the word pure, you can't have any error. You can't have any corruptness. You can't have any of that stuff. In order for it to be pure. So how can you take a book and say, and some people will say, yeah, you know, it's there's corruptions in here. It's not perfect. How can you say, well, that's God's word? It's not God's word because every word of God is pure. There is no corruption. It's the incorruptible seed. If you're going to make a claim and say God's word, you better not have impurities in God's word, because then it's not God's word anymore. Every word of God is pure. Praise God. We could have his words that are pure and unadulterated and exactly the way that he has them for us. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Look at verse number 6. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee and thou be found a liar. And there are many warnings in the Bible. I'm going to briefly go over a few of them. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse number 2, the Bible reads, ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. Turn if you would to Revelation 22 real quick. Deuteronomy chapter 12, verse 32 reads, what things soever I command you, observe to do it, thou shalt not add thereto, nor diminish from it. He's saying, I'm giving you my words. I'm giving you my law. These are my words. Hey, don't add unto it, and don't remove from it. And we need to remember both. Now, the don't remove from it seems to be pretty easy and straightforward. Like, I can't touch God's word by taking something away I don't like, right? Because that would be the tendency, is to think that, like, well, I don't really like this, so I'm going to remove it. And that's real easy to comprehend and say, yeah, we definitely shouldn't be doing that. But we also want to make sure we're not adding to God's word either. In our life and in our zeal to live right and do right by God, let's not get caught up and start adding to God's word. Start calling things that are not a sin a sin. Well, now you're starting to add to God's word. I mean, that's what the Pharisees did. Right? They were constantly trying to find the reason why Jesus Christ was wrong and why his disciples were wrong and all this other stuff. Right? We need to make sure we don't get caught up in that. We don't want to add to or remove from God's word. Let's be real with what the scripture says. And hey, what it says, what it doesn't say, it doesn't say. And that's why, for example, we look at the list of the things that a person can do in order to be, say, kicked out of church. You know, you look at those sins. I'm not going to just start adding to those things and say, well, if you've done this to me or whatever, then you're not welcome here anymore. No, that's not what the Bible says. You know what I mean? We're going to go exactly with what the scripture says. We're not going to add to it, and we're not going to remove from it either and say, well, we don't want to kick anyone out. Well, no. Now all of a sudden you got a problem. But God is very, very, very concerned with the integrity of his word. So much so that we see in Revelation 22 the price of tampering, adding to or removing from his word. Because this is all we have. This is what we have to go on, is God's word. Right? He's not audibly speaking with us and communicating it with us on a daily basis. It's not something that we just say, hey God, and we're having a conversation with him. What we have is his word. So he needs to make sure that you don't mess with my word, because I want this word to be, preserved for everybody to be able to get this and to get my message and to know exactly what I said. So if anyone decides to try to mess it up and screw with it, look at Revelation 22, verse 18. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. It costs you your soul, basically, to add to or remove from God's words. That's how serious it is. God says, you know what? You start doing that, you've lost your chance of salvation forever. Not something that I'd want to mess with, I'll tell you that much. Even as an unbeliever, I mean, seeing something like that, if I was an unbeliever, I'd be like, yeah, you know what? On the off chance that this is right, I don't think I want to mess with that. You know what I mean? I don't want to lose my place from the book of life. But let's go back to Proverbs chapter 30. Verse number 7, Proverbs 37. Two things have I required of thee, deny me them not before I die. Remove far from me vanity and lies. Which is the first thing, because he's saying he's asking for two things. Give me neither poverty nor riches, feed me with food convenient for me. Lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and steal and take the name of my God in vain. I love these few verses here on Proverbs. I try to keep this in my mind all the time. This is very, very good wisdom to live by, to keep you humble and to keep you focused on what's important instead of on vanity. He says, first, remove far from me vanity and lies. Why? I don't want to get caught up in vain things. If it's removed far from me, then I won't be tempted to get involved in things that are just vain and meaningless and are not that good. I'm just going to remove it far from me. And apply this. Why don't you remove from yourself things that are vain that you know could be a problem for you? Just get them out. Don't worry about the vanity. You know, get the vain things that you have in your life right now. Get it out. It says, and lies. Right? Remove far. I don't want to be deceived. I don't want people lying to me. God, remove far from me vanity and lies. I want to get caught up in things that don't matter. I don't want to get caught up in things that are just a bunch of lies. I want to know the truth. I want to do what's right. Get the false prophet books and preaching and whatever out of your house too. Get it far from me. I don't want any of that stuff. And then he says, give me neither poverty nor riches. He's saying, I don't want to be really poor, but I also don't want to be really rich. I don't want to be so poor. He says, feed me with food convenient for me. God, just give me what I need. Provide for me the food so I'm not going to be, or he says, first of all, so lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord, right? So when you start accumulating riches and you start gaining all this wealth, you can get to the point to where you get real proud because you have all this stuff and you start thinking, I did all this. I'm so great. Look at everything I've achieved. Look at all that I've done. And you end up just denying God. And he's recognizing, look, this is the way that people are and can be. I don't want to be like that, God. So don't even give me the opportunity to be like this. So don't let me get rich. How many Christians today are willing to say, God, don't make me rich? This is wisdom. This is wisdom. Don't get fooled by thinking how great it would be to be rich, because for the Christian, it's not. For the unsaved, lost person, yeah, it's great. But not for the one that really cares about God's word and actually is thinking about the afterlife and thinking about the things ahead. I don't want to be rich, and I don't. I don't want to be rich. Because you know what? When you have a lot of money, you're going to end up wasting a lot of time on vain things anyways. Because when you have money, what are you going to do? You're going to spend it. You're going to spend it on what? What are you going to spend it on? Toys, things you have to maintain, things you have to care for, things you have to hire other people to take care of. And, you know, it's vanity. And it's a waste of time. And you end up wasting your entire life on that. And you could just start thinking, whoa, I did all this. Look how great I am. Look at all the stuff I have. I have more than all the, everyone else around me. Because I'm so great. We need to watch out for that. So he says, lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and steal and take the name of my God in vain. He's saying, I also don't want to be so poor that my only choice is like, you know, I might be tempted. Not my only choice is, because no one's only choice is to steal ever. That's never your only choice. There's always another way around it. But to be tempted into thinking that I'm so hungry and I need food, I'm going to steal to satisfy my hunger, right? Because when you start getting real hungry, you start thinking about all kinds of different things, whatever you can do to get food. And he's saying, I don't want to be in that situation either. So please, God, give me what I need. Give me food convenient for me. I don't want too much because I don't want to just deny you and just, you know, get puffed up in my own vain mind. And I also don't want to get to the point to where I'm going to be willing to break your laws and your commandments in order to feed myself. So just help me out. Great wisdom to live by. Memorize these verses. I think they'll help you. In today's society, this is extremely important. The number one of the easiest things to get distracted with is money and the cares of this world and the pleasures and the vain things. This will help keep you on track. And this is a great summary of kind of like all the rest of the Proverbs that dealt with this subject. Dealing with riches and all these things. Let's keep going here. Verse number 10. Accuse not a servant unto his master, lest he curse thee and thou be found guilty. You're saying, don't be a tattletale. Right? That's what it's saying. Don't accuse. Accuse not a servant unto his master. Right? Don't go and say, hey, boss, look, do you know what so-and-so, you know, do you know what this person did? Because what he's saying is, you know what? What if that, it's going to turn around on you, and then you're going to be found guilty. You don't need to be doing the spying and enforcement of things that are going on and righting every wrong that if someone else screws up, or you're just going to be right there to tell them how your fellow employee screwed up to the boss, right? I was saying, don't do that. Let the judgment come where it's appropriate, because you know what's going to happen is the same way that you judge is going to, you're going to be judged also. And then when you screw up, because look, we all make mistakes. I don't care who you are. You're proud if you think you never make a mistake, you never make an error, you never screw things up. When you're looking and pouncing on someone that makes a mistake and telling on them to the boss, it's going to come back and get you. When you screw up, and you know what? It'll probably be even worse for you because you did that. Don't be a tattletale. Look at verse number 11. There is a generation that curseth their father and doth not bless their mother. There is a generation that are pure in their own eyes and yet is not washed from their filthiness. There is a generation, oh, how lofty are their eyes, and their eyelids are lifted up. There is a generation whose teeth are as swords and their jaw teeth as knives to devour the poor from off the earth and the needy from among men. There is a generation that we are going to be seeing probably in our lifetime, and things are already getting this way. Right now, this generation that is being described right here is going to happen in the end times. Turn, if you would, to 2 Timothy chapter 3. Matthew 24, verse 12 reads, "And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold." This generation that we're looking at here in Proverbs chapter 30, there's a generation that curseth their father and mother. How wicked is that, first of all? Just children that curse their parents. The Bible says that if a child, you know, when the children are cursing their father and mother, they deserve the death penalty. He said there's going to be a society so backwards, a generation that curses their father and does not bless their mother. No respect whatsoever, no honor for their parents at all. An entire generation. And we're not talking one person here, one person. He's saying there's a generation coming that they're not going to care anything about their parents. There's a generation that are pure in their own eyes. They're going to think they're righteous. Yeah, what we're doing is right and good. We've got the truth. And yet is not washed from their filthiness. They don't have the truth. They're not pure, but they think they are. They think what they're doing is right. There's a generation, oh, how lofty are their eyes. They're going to be proud, thinking how great they are, how they've got everything figured out. And their eyelids lifted up. There's a generation whose teeth are as swords. You're using your words like weapons, and their jaw teeth as knives to devour the poor from off the earth. They don't care about people. They don't care about the poor and the needy from among men. I believe this generation is almost upon us. I think things are going that way. I think as iniquity abounds, the love of many is going to wax cold. And because iniquity is abounding right now, people's love is waxing cold to breed this generation that's going to think they have all the answers. They're going to be ruthless. They're going to be unmerciful as they use their teeth as swords. They're proud. They think they got it all figured out. They think that they're pure, but they're not. They're filthy. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 1. This is why I say this is coming upon us and this is going to happen. Verse number 1, "This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves." Lovers of their own selves, right? They're pure in their own eyes. They can't do anything wrong. They're lovers of their own selves. Covetous, boasters, proud, right? We saw that already in Proverbs 30. Blasphemers, disobedient to parents, right? A generation that curseth their father and doth not bless their mother. Unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Again, they have this form of godliness. They think they're pure in their own eyes, but they don't even know that they're filthy. They deny the power thereof. They have a religion. They have a form of godliness. But it's wicked and false and perverted. They're proud. And this is prophesying. This is talking about the last days. Perilous times shall come. And this is what we see in Proverbs chapter 30. Now, I know what you're thinking, because I'm thinking this too. Maybe you're not thinking this. But at the beginning, I said that word prophesy. We see here in Proverbs chapter 30. There's nothing about, you know, end times here or future events. let's say, okay, this is about future events. Now, this isn't necessary. I'm applying this to end times events. Okay? But Proverbs 31 also says that it's a prophecy. And you read through that, and that's not talking about end times. So the point still stands. There's more than just one application for this. Okay? And the word, I didn't do a full Bible study on it for tonight. Like, I've done it before. I've looked at it, and it's definitely the truth. But I just want to make sure I make that clarification, because you say, well, wait a minute, Pastor Berzins, we're looking at future stuff here, and it's talking about a prophecy, right? So we'll get to that. You know, I'll make a point of it next week when we do Proverbs 31. But just keep that in mind. Anyway, that's a kind of a sidestep. Go back, if you would, to Proverbs chapter 30. We see here how much they line up, though, when it's talking about there's a generation that has all these things. Now, these generations, I think, also can be, they come and go throughout history. Right? I mean, as nations and people become wicked, all of this stuff repeats. But it's definitely coming in the end times. It's definitely going to happen, as we see there in 2 Timothy chapter 3. I mean, we know for a fact that that's happening, and we can see the way it's happening right now. Proverbs 3, look at verse number 15. The horse leech hath two daughters, crying, give, give. There are three things that are never satisfied. Yea, four things say not, it is enough. Now, when I was studying for this, I didn't know exactly what a horse leech was. And from my understanding, what I could tell, what it is just a leech. Like a big leech, though. That, you know, a leech is like a blood-sucking beast or creature, right? And it fits with the rest of what we're going to read here, because it says that the horse leech had two daughters crying, give, give, right? And it's followed up with, there's three things that are never satisfied. Yea, four things say not, it is enough. And you think of a leech, like they're just going to suck and suck and suck, and they're never satisfied and just leech off of you, right? I mean, that's what a leech does. It's just never has enough. It's like a parasite that just is never satisfied and never full. And that's why it starts off with that. Look at verse number 16. So these are the things, the four things, that are never satisfied. The grave, people are always dying. The grave's never full. The graves are never satisfied. There's always people dying. The barren womb, right? There's always people that aren't able to have children. Unfortunately, there's barren wombs all over the place. The people that want to have children, they don't have children. The earth that is not filled with water. I mean, think about all the water that's in this world. We still have ground, we still have dry land. And then in the fire that saith not, it is enough. I mean, think about how consumptive a fire is, right? I mean, it burns everything in sight. Verse 17, the eye that mocketh at his father and despiseth to obey his mother, the ravens of the valley shall pick it out, and the young eagles shall eat it. Kids, listen up. I'm going to read that verse again. This is important. The eye that mocketh at his father. We were just reading the verse about the generation that's going to come, that they're going to curse their father and not bless their mother. It's a wicked generation. And the Bible's saying here, the eye that mocketh at his father, makes fun of their dad, doesn't respect their dad, doesn't have honor for their dad. The eye that mocks at his father and despiseth to obey his mother, don't want to listen to anything mom says. I don't want to do what you say, mom. I don't want to go clean my room. I don't want to do this. Look at what the Bible says. The ravens of the valley shall pick it out, and the young eagles shall eat it. This is all about birds eating out your eyeballs. Does anyone want their eyeballs eaten out? Because I know I don't. That doesn't sound like one bit of fun. I don't like getting a speck of dust in my eye. It's really annoying, and it hurts, and it's like, oh, man, and it disables you, let alone a bird plucking out my eyeball. This is how serious that God treats the honoring of your father and mother, and saying that, look, kids, you need to respect your mother and your father and listen to what they say. Look at verse number 18. There be three things which are too wonderful for me, yea, four which I know not. The way of an eagle in the air, the way of a serpent upon a rock, the way of a ship in the midst of the sea, and the way of a man with a maid. And he's just kind of bringing up some things here that are just, it's a wonder. It's wonderful to look at these things, the way an eagle flies through the air, and the way of a man with a maid, the way that a ship just, sails through the sea. These things are wonders, and it's just exemplary of God's creation. right? I mean, some of these are you know, a ship is man's creation, but the way that everything works and the way that God's world works is wonderful. Verse number 20, such is the way of an adulterous woman. She eateth and wipeth her mouth and saith, I have done no wickedness. And we covered this earlier in earlier Proverbs when we talked about the strange woman and the adulterous woman, how she's, you know, extremely wicked and filthy and defiled, but, you know, eats, wipes her mouth, you know, I'm clean, right? There's nothing wrong with what I did. And thinking that everything is just fine. And this is the way that the world deals with adultery anyways. It's just looked upon as not that big of a deal. I mean, people, it happens. Oh, I'm having a hard time at home, and oh, I had an affair with so-and-so. But you don't understand. My husband, he doesn't pay attention to me, you know, and all and on and on and on, like you didn't do anything wrong. When it's wicked as hell, and the Bible puts a death penalty on adultery. Proverbs, verse 21. For three things the earth is disquieted, and for four which it cannot bear. For a servant when he reigneth, and a fool when he is filled with meat. For an odious woman when she is married, and a handmaid that is heir to her mistress. So these are all things that are kind of like opposites that are happening here. You know, the servant that's ruling and reigning, because the servant is working for someone else, right? It's talking about the fool that is filled with meat. Right? Because a fool isn't going to be working. They're not going to, you know, they're going to be acting foolishly and not doing and being responsible. So when they're actually filled with meat, that's kind of the opposite of what should happen. An odious woman, you know, someone who's loud, obnoxious, getting married, right? Finding someone to marry him, and a handmaid that is heir to her mistress. Again, the handmaid, someone that's like a servant, then becoming heir to mistress. He says that the earth is disquieted or for these things that it cannot bear. Right, because that's not the way that it should be having any of these things happen. Look at verse number 24. There be four things which are little upon the earth, but they are exceeding wise. Now, everybody, pay attention. Exceeding wise. There's some wisdom that we can gain from God's creation, from the way that He made the animals, and we're going to see specifically what we can learn here. Look at verse 25. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their meat in the summer. The conies are but a feeble folk, yet make they their houses in the rocks. The locusts have no king, yet go they forth, all of them by bands. The spider taketh hold with her hands and is in king's palaces. So all these things are little. The ants, the conies, the locusts, and the spider. But they're doing great things. So the ants, they're able to prepare all of their food and store everything away, and they have this great wisdom, even though they're super tiny, right? And they're able to store away their food, and they prepare their meat in the summer. So when the hard times come, when they're not going to be able to find anything, they're taken care of. The conies, it says they're a feeble folk, yet they make their houses in rocks. They got a stronghold, a strong dwelling place to live in, but they're these little things. Right? But somehow they're able to have a great fortress for themselves. Locusts, they have no king. They have no leader giving them all their direction, yet they're able to all come together and go in bands and you know, work together to achieve a task. And it says, the spider taketh hold with her hands and is in king's palaces. Right? A little things, little creatures able to do great things. Even if you, and I think one of the things that we learn from this is even if you are small and weak and you think you're nobody, as Acre started off in the beginning of this chapter, you know, I'm not anybody. I'm more brutish than any man. I don't have the understanding of man. You know, I don't have the words of the words of the holy. I'm nobody. He did a great thing here. I mean, you know, giving us Proverbs chapter 30. You can be small and weak and still do great things if you're wise, if you have the wisdom. These creatures, these creations of God, these small creatures, they're magnificent, but the Bible says that they're exceeding wise. And the things that they do, they're exceeding wise. You may not have much, you may not be much. Get wisdom, which is why we're here every week, learning Proverbs, right? Let's get this wisdom so we can do great things too. God could use us to do many great things. Look at verse number 29. There be three things which go well, yea, four are comely in going. a lion which is strongest among beasts and turneth not away for any, a greyhound, and he-goat also, and a king against whom there is no rising up. And that kind of summarizes, or not summarizes it, it's bringing to a close the, you notice as we're going through, you know, there's three things that are too wonderful, yea, four. There's three things that, you know, the four things are little upon the earth. There's three things that the earth is disquieted for. And he goes through all these random things, not necessarily, not random, but he goes through all these different examples of these things and then wraps it up with the three things which go well. Right, a lot of them, there's problems here, there's problem here, there's some wisdom we can learn here, and then there's things that are just kind of right the way they are. You know, the lion, strongest among the beasts, turns not away for any. And we're supposed to have boldness like a lion. Remember, I think it was this last week where I was preaching about having that boldness, it was having the boldness of a lion and not cowering down when the wicked arise and want to challenge your faith and spread their wickedness. Then he goes, you know, a greyhound, a he-goat, and a king against whom there's no rising up. Verse number 32, we're almost done. If thou hast done foolishly in lifting up thyself, or if thou hast thought evil, lay thine hand upon thy mouth. Surely the churning of milk bringeth forth butter, and the wringing of the nose bringeth forth blood. So the forcing of wrath bringeth forth strife. So just as much as you keep on churning milk, you're going to get butter. Right? You keep on mixing it up, you're going to make butter. As much as you're going to, you know, you wring someone's nose, blood's going to come out. That's a sure thing. It's going to happen. He says, so the forcing of wrath bringeth forth strife. And strife, of course, is fighting. So when you're forcing wrath on a situation and just bringing wrath down, you're going to start a fight. And you know, we're not called to just start all these fights and force wrath. Obviously, is something that we need to be careful of. And it's tied in, I think, in that verse 32. If thou hast done foolishly in lifting up thyself, you know, getting a little proud, or if thou hast thought evil, lay thine hand upon thy mouth. So he's saying, you're thinking evil things and you're getting all proud and lifted up. Cover your mouth. Don't be saying the things that are going to come as a result of your pride or as a result of you thinking evil against someone else. Because as surely as these other things happen, the forcing of wrath bringeth forth strife. You're just going to bring a fight as a result of your pride or of your evil thoughts against other people. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the great wisdom that we have here in the book of Proverbs. Lord, we pray that you would please help us all to study your words, dear Lord, and to just accept the Bible for what it says. I pray that you would please help us all to walk home tonight and not forget the things that we've read and the things that we've learned, but that we would remember them and keep them and do them, dear Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.